A couple of years after I graduated, after I'd been in my practice for maybe 2 or 3 years, I went back to Duke for, I don't know if it was exams or, you know, meetings, maybe a conference of something. And I was in the Raleigh-Durham airport, and this very nice older woman came up to me, and she said, "Oh my God, dearie, you have dead people hanging all over you." And she started dusting me off like I had dog hair or dandruff or styrofoam all over me. And then after she was done dusting me off, she stepped backwards for a minute. She looked me over and she said, "Now, isn't that better?" And she wandered off into the crowd. And I didn't think about it at the time, but later on began to wonder what exactly she meant by that. I did feel a little better, a little lighter. So when I went to school, HIV was like the hottest topic in medicine, in my opinion. I have a tendency to be interested in infectious disease, and I was super interested. It was the very beginning. It was before, very early on when it was not called HTLV-3 anymore, but HIV. And nobody really knew what that meant, but I thought it was something that, as a PA, that I wanted to kind of jump into. So I had some pushback from the initial administration of the PA program when I was in North Carolina, and they told me that PAs weren't really suitable for taking care of people with HIV, and I still don't understand that, but I was able to demonstrate by going through a rotation in pediatric hematology oncology, so that's cancer for kids, that I had the right stuff to, I guess, have my heart broken by the tragic stories. But also, I think they put me there for a really good reason, is that a lot of the sickle cell kids who had multiple transfusions actually had HIV at that time. This was about the time of Ryan White, if people remember that. So I did the rotation, and I did really well, and I decided to come back to California, to San Francisco, because that was kind of the epicenter. I was from Northern California anyway, and I was looking for a practice. I happened to drop a curriculum vitae, which is what PAs call their resumes, at Ralph K. Davies Hospital, with a practice that turned out to be the first internal medicine practice for gay men. It was solely focused on gay men, and almost all of them had HIV disease. So I was hired by the three doctors there. They specifically wanted a PA because they felt like they could mold me into their image. And it was like the best possible place I could have been. I'm really grateful for it. The Castro, when I first experienced it, was, you know what I've said, it was the best of times and it was the worst of times. There was a great sadness in the community, but there was also an indescribable joy, like being wrapped in warm honey, you know, just like the end of a wonderful summer's day. People were pulling together to try and make things happen, even kind of discrete parts of the community. There was a lot of joy with, you know, like eating out or going shopping or, you know, reading the obituary page had its upside. So the Bay Area Reporter at the time, where everybody would immediately turn to the obituaries were, although extremely sad, were finely crafted little gems of joy about somebody's life. So they called the obituary page the gay men's sports page. So there was also that like grim humor there where they laughed at themselves even while they were dying. And it was incredibly powerful. I remember one of my patients was one of the first people on AZT. He was probably one of the first 10 people on it. And it really, really helped him for a while. But, you know, the virus mutated and it started to not help him anymore. And even as he was losing his sight, He had the greatest joy in his life, and he was laughing about everything. Everything was kind of on the edge of being a party, even though it was grim. I didn't know it at the time. You see, I walked in here, and I didn't really get the magnitude of what I was walking into. This practice was specifically mentioned in the band played on, and they used the doctor who started it, his name was Bud Boucher. He was passed away, but unfortunately, by the time I was in the practice, but his vision was definitely being carried on by the three internal medicine physicians. Actually, two internal medicine physicians, one infectious disease physician. I think this might be a good place to say they were taking care of their community. They were taking care of their friends. They were probably taking care of people that were their lovers and people they had political ties with. Because there was a lot of political action going on with ACT UP. This was about a year before ACT UP was born, before they shut down the San Francisco Bridge, Golden Gate Bridge. And it was an immense burden for them to be watching their community get sick, knowing they had the talents that they had, but at that time there wasn't much you could do for it because this was way in the beginning of AZT, which was the first antiretroviral that was available to treat this infection, and way before protease inhibitors, which were the ones, of course, that made the difference. The medicine was really easy. You have to remember there were really no resources to keep people alive and healthy for very long. And this was a curious disease that destroyed the immune system in very specific ways over and over and over again. And so it reminded me of the Ghostbusters movie where one of the characters is asked, choose the form of the destructor. And then all of a sudden we have the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. So what it was like is if somebody was particularly handsome, then he would get Kaposi's sarcoma all over his face. If someone was particularly muscular and athletic, he would get wasting syndrome. If somebody was intellectually brilliant, they would go into the dementia. And somebody who was like an athlete might lose lung function from pneumocystis pneumonia. And it was really important to us to draw a line and say with this disease, okay, you're giving this guy pneumocystis pneumonia, we got this, we'll put him in the hospital, we'll treat him, we'll make him better, and you will never bother him again. And then of course that was never meant to be. We lost 3 or 4 patients a week, which is super unusual for an internal medicine practice. And I just remember thinking about how particularly cruel it was for these young men who never, a lot of them were only 18 or 19 years old. They only recently moved to San Francisco and come out. And a lot of times their families didn't even know. And so all of a sudden they were being destroyed in the most personalized way possible. So it was easy enough to pick somebody out who had pneumocystis pneumonia. I could see what that was like when they were walking from the waiting room to the exam room. And I could get it diagnosed probably in a couple hours because the access to care was different then. And I could get what I needed to diagnose and treat somebody really relatively simply. But it's just that we're always drawing lines in the sand, and the disease, of course, paid no attention to us. So I had, in my particular office at my desk, sitting next to me was a man who had worked with these doctors for a long time, was part of the community, and he had done their billing for him, and then he was also a lab tech, so he did some lab tech stuff. And he asked me one day what it meant to have a big blind spot in his vision. Of course, he knew what it meant. It meant he had CMV retinitis, and I picked it out like, in a second, the dismayed look on my face and that saying, we have to get you in, we're gonna draw the line here, it's not gonna, But people don't get CMV retinitis when they have very many T cells. So T cells below 50 are kind of when that happens. And this was a really terrible day. He didn't last very long after that. He chose to kill himself, probably within the week. And the doctors they had to go to his house. They had to declare him dead. And he shot himself, so it probably wasn't hard to do. And then they had to comfort I'll call him his husband, because they were married, as far as I'm concerned, for at least 30 years. And talk to the office, which of course was devastated because he was a pivotal part of all the work we did every day. So it was that personalized and that fast and that tragic. I saw the greatest love stories that I've ever seen in my life while I was there. And we have to remember, for the context, that there was no legal marriage between two gay men. And there was even some argument of what they should call each other, because they would, you know, husband didn't really fit legally, lover seemed too personal to him, partner seemed too clinical to him, date, it kind of implied not really a longevity to the relationships that they had. And then some other relationships were pretty open, and that was kind of scandalous for the time. So they didn't even have a good word for what they were to each other. But I compare them to my grandparents, who were married almost 70 years. And I say there is no difference. And so I also saw great love stories in groups of friends who gathered around a sick individual that they really didn't owe very much to, but they committed themselves to, and especially for the long haul, because it wasn't very pleasant and it wasn't very quick. So examples of that, you know, remember, it wasn't legal to have a partner be in the hospital when somebody was in the ICU, but the nurses at Ralph K. Davies were the first ones to buck that trend, and they just let it happen anyway. So heroes in their own right. I saw people in the intensive care unit dying with their partner next to them, holding their hand while the parents were cleaning out the apartment of anything valuable. So it's super disappointing in a lot of the families. And a lot of the families, it was the first time they'd ever heard that their son was gay, and to find out that he was dying in an ICU. But there, in my opinion, there was a better way to handle it. I saw two men who were husband and husband for probably about 30 years. One was blind and one was demented, and they were in beds next to each other. And the blind one would hold the one with dementia's hand, because he would get aggravated. And but when they somehow let go, he couldn't find his partner, so the nurses would come in and put their hands together again, and they would calm down, and that's how they died, hand in hand, almost at the same time. So incredibly amazing love stories. I saw a man who was going to UC Berkeley, and his dorm floor, when they found out he was sick, which was pretty easy to figure out because he had Kaposi's all over his face, they organized a kind of like a friend's care committee, but much more personalized, much more loving than that, where they took shifts in his house to take care of him, you know, to wash him, to get him to the toilet, to take care of his animals, to, you know, make sure his groceries were there and he had what food he could eat. And how, you know, who went to run this errands for him and things like that. And it was probably a group of about 30 people. And I thought, I'd never seen anything like that. I thought that was incredible. I also saw the first spreadsheet that two programmers who were in long-term relationship together, and one was really, really sick and on 45 medicines a day, and his husband was able to make a computer like spreadsheet, and I'd never seen that before. Remember, this is in 1987 or 88. And I was like blown away. And I was thinking, man, if we could have this tool, that would be so helpful in keeping track of all these medicines. Dun, dun, dun. And now we do. I saw, or I heard about, I think I knew the patient, but I wasn't there when he actually passed, where a group of fans, he wanted to go to Las Vegas one more time, but he was too sick to get out of bed. And so they fixed up a van for him with a bed, and they drove him to Las Vegas. And I don't think he died there, but he was able to be there one less time. And so the creativity and that caring was amazing. And you guys probably know about Open Hand, which a woman I know as Ruth, she hasn't, you know, she's known, but she organized meals for people to take to meals and then to patients to make sure they stay fed. And then Coming Home Hospice was, I think, an act of great love by the community. And I think it was, I'm not certain who really started it, but there was definitely a gay woman's presence in that. And they were able to, I guess, buy an old convent, which is only a block off 18th and Castro. It's beautiful, it's light and airy and has like little rooms like you would imagine a convent or a dorm having, and they created an amazing place for people to go to die, where there was singing and there was happiness and there was cleanliness around them and care and love. So the thing I remember the most though is I was on a third story office and I remember looking down at the little plaza that was in between my office building and the hospital. And my patient, Tim, who was dying of AIDS-related lymphoma, it was one of those late summer afternoons, and San Francisco gets beautifully golden then. I don't know if you know, but it does. And his mother was there reading poetry to him in the last of the evening light. And I remember thinking, that's incredible. I don't really want to be that mom, but I want to be that mom, you know. She was incredible for him and there. So those are the love stories that I remember the most. I maintain that it's strange to get a celebration of life sent to you in the individual's own personal handwriting. Okay, so this wasn't a computer age, things were personal, and there was something about a person being able to anticipate their death to the point where they could plan out their whole funeral and plan out their whole obituary and make sure all the right people showed up and it was a huge event. So it just was a little, you know, I would get these cards and I would recognize the handwriting, and then at times you have to kind of break down and cry because you realize how bravely they went into it and how even at the end there was this determination to feel joy. So amazing joy. So as an example of that, I was asked to pronounce somebody dead who had died at home. And in the middle of his dying breaths was an incredible party going on. So there maybe were 75 to 100 people there. He was dying in a bedroom. It was fully decorated. He was laid out in beautiful clothes that he would really appreciate because he was an entertainer. That was his style. And when I went there after work to pronounce him dead, I remember just looking at him and kind of being with him for a little bit and being sad because he was my friend. I didn't really know him as an entertainer. I knew him as a really, really brave soul. He went through a lot of hard things. So I gently took his wrist, and by then he was in rigor and he was cold. And so what that means is that his body was no longer limber and no longer warm. So I remember it being like, so abruptly different from the reality that was going around in the rest of the apartment. And it was like a shocking pain, you know, kind of in my heart. But he went out the way he wanted to. And I think it was extraordinary. He was an extraordinary man. He's kind of still known in the area. I'm sure people remember him. But he was so brave in his struggles and so happy to let his burdens down and to pass on. And I imagine that he's in charge of the music in heaven, because he would be. The other thing is that kind of I should talk about is I was in my office on the third story of the office building during the Loma Prieta earthquake, which we just celebrated, the 33 years passing. And I was walking down the hallway to talk to one of the doctors. It was, as you guys recall, shortly after 5. And I was on high heels, never my best effort, but I couldn't. So I was slammed against the wall, and I remember looking at each other in terror because we all hit the door jams. But at that moment in time, I was walking down to talk to the physician I worked with because I had 2 people on hold who were dying at home. And what I found out later is there was a third who died in the hospital right during the earthquake. So I don't think the 2 I had on the phone were actually dying, but the one in the hospital actually did die. And he was quite a dramatic person. And when I figured that out later, I had a lot of, I guess, happiness to think that that would be totally the exit he would plan. Not to hurt anybody else, but to make it as dramatic as possible. And because he was just kind of that kind of person. And so I can look at it with a little more happiness than terror, which is good. The other thing, too, I don't think it's as well known, is there were a lot of, I think a lot of bodies got disposed of off the side of the Golden Gate Bridge. This was only rumor. I didn't know of anybody personally. But a lot of the men who died never wanted to leave San Francisco, and that's the way they did. Remember, the embalmers in the funeral homes initially wouldn't touch them. And so that I imagine that there were bodies that were tossed over that were never found. And I think there's a really honor in honoring the wishes of the person who finally found the place that they belonged in the world and never wanted to leave. So very brave friends that were able to do that for them. I would imagine that was difficult. I never really went to any of the funerals because I preferred to remember the people as I knew them, as individual patients, and not so much as really who they were in the community, because I had very close personalized relationship with them, and part of the success of that was not only knowing them in that way. So I had a bizarre side practice where I attended videotapes of people's will signing. And if their wills were ever challenged in court by maybe a hostile family member or something, I was there to provide my medical opinion that the people signed their wills in sound mind. So that their partners could, you know, get businesses and things like that. There was a lot of money involved in some of these. And I still, to the day, think that's a failure. That I was glad I was there for those people, but I shouldn't have had to be there. So. So one thing these guys did is they lived off their credit cards and they blew them up because they were going to die. And so that's what some of this is.
Some of what is? What do you have?
This gift from Tiffany's, the sterling silver pen. It's beautiful. This kid that gave it to me, look how beautiful, very Art Deco.
Oh, wow.
This kid probably made $20,000 a year of that. So, you know, they would go on trips and they would buy expensive Christmas. Christmas was a big deal, so we got a lot of Christmas gifts. And this is an example of one of the ones that I know came from somebody who really couldn't afford it, and it was quite dear, and it was quite thoughtful too, because we wrote charts. So, you know, I think he was observant enough about me to know that this would be a good gift for me. So that was touching. That was also the same young man who was from the South. His name was Joe. He had a great recipe for pound cake that his grandmother gave him. And it was really important to him that I get it. And as you can see, this recipe is well-loved. It's a really great recipe. But we were talking about pound cake. I guess he brought us some. And I was saying, oh, that's so amazing. That's so great. And he knew that I went to school in the South. So this is his grandmother's Southern pound cake recipe. That's a treasure going to be handed down in my family for sure. So, but every time I look at it, I remember Joe. So the next one, I think what they did was they gave me treasures in little parts of their life so that they could be remembered. And so this man was Stephen, and he gave me, he had these race cars, probably from the time he was 3 or something. And he broke up his collection, and he gave one to each of the people that he wanted to have a memory of him, but also I think he had to be on a special list to get one. And so I've always thought that I was on a special list because I got an orange race car. I'm not really certain what kind of car it is, but a 3-year-old boy probably thought that was pretty cool.
His name
was Stephen. So I worked with him. I did a lot of home visits for him because he was bedbound. And I didn't really do very much except sit there and talk to him and hang out. But I have this by my bed, and he makes me smile every morning. So thanks, Stephen. So another thing was, it was really important to celebrate Christmas because you never really knew when your last one was. So I have a lot of Christmas ornaments, but this is one that I like. And this person, he went out and spent a lot of time looking for the perfect ornament. And in my case, he found it. So I really like roses. One of my daughter's middle names is Rose. And I don't know how he knew that, but every time I decorate for Christmas, I don't really have a tree. I just put things up on the walls and stuff. But this is maybe one of the 10 ornaments that's always there. So super important and quite treasured. Okay. Now the next one is, I took care of a patient who was born in Berlin. And this was about the time that the Berlin Wall fell down. And part of the way that he spent his money was he went back home to see what Berlin looked like without the wall. So this is what the wall looks like without Berlin. Okay. It's not really spray painted. I suppose you could say it's maybe he just got it out of the parking lot, but I don't believe that because this was an important event to him. This is how I remember him, with joy that his hometown was brought back together again. And so this is one of the treasures that whenever I see you, I remember taking care of him. Okay. And then I saved I think one of the best for last. I have so many. I only brought a couple whose stories are easiest to tell. This is Norman's jacket. Very 80s. And I know you guys can't see this. Norman gave this to me when he was dying of liver disease, so he was yellow when he gave this to me. This he identified this as the jacket that he wore to his wedding. And I don't know exactly legally what he meant by that, but I'm going with it. So this little medal here, which I actually just looked at it as I was bringing it here. I've never really looked at it before. It's an attendance award. I think he said he went to Catholic school. So this is something the nuns gave him for showing up every day. And he thought it was important for me to have. Now, I guess he thought I was going to wear it because in the 80s, you're thinking this is going to be like the way, you know, the chic look forever, but not so much. But I do treasure it, and I have it in my house in Crescent City to keep it safe so it's immediately by me. And I'll always appreciate Norman, but as I remember, he tried it on and he was yellow from the jaundice. He said it wasn't really his color anymore, and he gave it to me. I went from being interested in HIV to the most incredible medical experience of my life for the 3.5 years that I was there. And I landed in the right place. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was kind of in the thick of it. I was the first PA who worked there, so I have a personal gratification for making PAs a really attractive and valuable asset to that situation. I thank the doctors that I worked with, Miles, David, and Wally, because they taught me medicine like I didn't learn at Duke. They gave me ways of relating to people that were extraordinary. They gave me a look into their community that was gracious and inclusive and kinder than the rest of the world treated them. And it was hard to leave, but I'm always drawn to Northern California, so I also wanted to have children, and that wasn't really the place for that. But I've always followed the individuals, and oftentimes I'll see something like, you know, a reference to the quilt or something, and I see somebody's name who I recognize, and I think I carry, maybe that's what this is, I carry the quilt around in my heart, and I think they didn't want to die, that was clear, but they also didn't want to be forgotten, and their stories are amazing. I'm glad the quilt exists. I'm glad you're recording this, because I think this is a story that really needs to be remembered, especially now, like how we treat certain segments of society in the medical realm because we can't relate to them or don't understand them or are slightly afraid of them. And I was glad that I was able to rise above the really real fear that my family had for me and my colleagues had for me, and given this amazing opportunity to prove them all wrong and to prove the community right, if they even really needed me to prove anything. I am honored to be able to take care of them, and I'll remain honored till my last day.
How do you keep from being swallowed by all the sadness?
Because there was so much joy. Because, like that guy's funeral, when that guy died, his name was Sammy, because he taught me how to be joyful. But, you know, he wasn't the only one, you know, because they taught me there's a great joy driving around San Francisco going shoe shopping with a drag queen. You know, there's a great joy walking down the Castro to find the not-so-bad Chinese restaurant that was there, and to going by like Harvey Milk's photography store and having the person you're with like casually reference him like they were bros, like they were buddies. But no, I used to cry all the time. So I lived in Half Moon Bay, and I commuted. That's kind of a hell of a commute, and I'm not a freeway driver, so I went through Devil's Slide before there was a tunnel, because that felt like more like home to me, you know? Mm-hmm. And I would send them off, every single one, I would sing, and I'm not a singer, so don't ask me to sing, but I would sing Amazing Grace for them when I was on my way home, and I was weeping and weeping and weeping and weeping, and it would somehow settle my heart. Thank you for telling the story. I'm not super into ghosts or anything, but I think I think the spirits that, whatever that lady saw, I think they're all happy to have had their moment in front of the camera.